So it seems lately that the United States military is a little bit paranoid about things that are floating over its airspace. Of course, we all know about the Chinese spy balloon that was shot down over the United States after it drifted over taking photos of highly sensitive sites, apparently. But now the attention seems to have shifted to a less sinister type of balloon. I came across an article talking about the shooting down of another balloon, which was over Yukon in northwestern Canada. And it speaks that this may have potentially been an amateur radio Pico balloon. Now, what is an amateur radio Pico balloon? Well, it is a small, lightweight balloon that's launched by amateur radio enthusiasts to conduct experiments in near space environments. These balloons, they typically measure 1 to 2 meters in diameter, and they can carry payloads of up to a few hundred grams. And they include payloads such as GPS, usually an amateur radio transmitter transmitting things such as APRS, which transmits its location, its altitude, and sends other telemetry data, perhaps temperature and other scientific measurements that they might be taking on that particular balloon itself. Now, of course, again, the purpose of these balloons is nothing sinister. It's to conduct experiments and to collect data on the atmosphere, weather and other environmental conditions at high altitudes. So they carry also other payloads such as cameras. We actually had an amateur radio group here in Australia launch a balloon which had a live camera feed on the bottom that was received by amateur radio operators all over the state, and they were able to receive that television transmission live, and I actually streamed it on this channel. It's pretty cool. I'll put a link in the description below if you'd like to re-watch the few hours worth of footage. The balloon in question, the call sign was K9YO-15, and that's an APRS call sign, and in actual fact, here is a screenshot of its last known location. You can see it's just off the coast of Alaska. Now, this article goes on to say that according to the Pentagon, the object shot down over Canada that day, the same day that it went missing, was a small metallic balloon with a tethered payload. They don't know exactly what these objects were yet. They haven't recovered them or found them, but it definitely seems like it was a Pico amateur radio balloon that was shot down. Without confirmation, of course, we can't say that for sure, but it certainly fits the bill. I sat down with a friend of mine, Mark, VK5QI, to explain a little bit more in detail about what this Pico balloon is. So you've done some of experiments with balloons before with the amateur radio club that you're associated with, and there's guidelines and approvals that you have to go through when you launch those?
Yeah. So here in Australia, we have to go through an approvals process with CASA. So we fill out a range of forms. We provide a risk assessment. We provide details on what we're flying, and we get an approval to launch from a certain location. We have to, and this applies for any payload that we launch. We fall into what's called the light balloon category, which is 50 grams to 4 kilograms. Though, as it turns out, some approvals processes are required for less than 50 gram payloads, as ridiculous as that is, but it's what it is. And we have to provide notification to CASA prior to our launch, and they will issue a notice to air missions on our behalf, allowing us to do the flight. We get our final approval from air traffic control just prior to the launch itself. This is in contrast to the US, where for payloads under 5.5 pounds, I could be wrong on this, there is no requirement to issue a NOTAM and no approvals required. So they can just launch. They're far less heavily regulated than we are. So we've had to go through this process every launch that we do. The whole thing with the FAA rules and the Pico balloons in that category is, so it's a real question of whether these Pico balloons really meet this kind of exempt category when they're traveling around the world, right? In the US mainland, fine, no issues at all. Everything underneath, I think it's 5 point something pounds, no approvals required.
But when it's outside their airspace, is it different?
Well, that's the thing. There's international regulations. They will agree that balloons for meteorological purposes can enter and exit their airspace. The question is, are these things for purely meteorological purposes? And you could argue that. You could also argue against that. I would say they're more for communications experimentation. They have been used for meteorological purposes, but is that the case for all of them? Don't know. These kind of trackers have geofencing in them, so they don't transmit over certain countries. The UK is one of them, because the UK doesn't allow amateur radio in the air, as it turns out. And, well, North Korea is the other one as well.
Obvious.
it's like, don't want to start World War III, apparently.
No.
So it's questionable, but I would say it's extremely low risk. Now, you're talking about payloads that are maxing out at maybe 15 grams.
A lot of the concern is that these fly at commercial aircraft altitudes. If one of these goes into an engine of, say, a commercial aircraft, it's pretty much going to just go straight out the other end and be chewed up.
I'm going to caveat this and say that I'm not an aerospace engineer. Probably.
Hmm.
It'll probably be fine.
In comparison to the Chinese spy balloon, which was massive, like, and obviously that was flying a lot higher, but still, like, that had a massive payload. Like, you could see it from the ground. Oh, yeah. These things you can't see from with the naked eye from the heights that they're at.
Yeah, you'd have great trouble seeing one of these for sure. But as for what damage it would do, my guess would be none. But again, I'm not an aerospace engineer. I guess it's also worth pointing out that a lot of these don't fly with batteries. So there's no lithium batteries to worry about in like almost all cases nowadays. People are either flying no batteries or they're flying supercapacitors. So that's even, you know, lower risk. Very lightweight, essentially party balloons with some helium in them. So I'd say that's quite low risk. Like, for me, the concern about, you know, what's come out of all of this over the last few days is not about the US military shooting down a amateur balloon. I mean, it's hilarious. It's crazy.
Especially since it's like $400,000 for a missile to take one out, out a $13.
Well, I'm going to say that the cost of what was flown, you know, there's a lot of development.
It varies. Yeah.
But for me, the concern is about the knee-jerk reaction in regulation space in the US. So what's going to happen to the current US regulations, which have worked so well for so many years? Are they going to crack down on this? Are they going to require more approvals? Is it going to become closer towards Australia's approach, where you have to go through an approvals process to do a balloon launch? You know, there was this really scary news article, scary to people that are in this hobby, saying, oh, every, you know, some senator in the US is saying every balloon should have a transponder on it. And by transponder, they mean ADS-B transponder. Do you know how much those things cost? The smallest one, like the one that would actually potentially be viable, I mean, forget about Pico balloons, but just for a regular latex balloon flight, they had $2,500. And suddenly you're flying a payload with a $2,500 transponder on it.
You'll probably never get back.
You really want to get it back, right?
Yeah.
And it's just crazy. Like for the amount of risk that these things pose, it's just over the top, crazily over the top. So hopefully sanity will prevail. And maybe there'll be some additional approvals required. I think that's probably okay. But going to the length of requiring a transponder, I mean, you're never going to get a transponder on all the radiosonde launches. If you think about that, I mean, in the US, and this is, they launch, I don't know how many hundreds of radiosondes a day, and there's never been an issue with those before. So why the extra regulation? And at this point, it'd be good to cut to a screenshot of the sond hub, what I call sond hub professional, showing all the balloons launched out, all the radiosondes launched out of the US.
Tell us quickly about sond hub and the interest that's just been generated over the past week with all of these balloon queries.
Yeah, so sond hub, I mean, there's two parts to sond hub. One is tracking of meteorological radiosondes, so your traditional weather balloons, but there's also sond hub amateur, which is tracking of amateur or hobbyist balloons. And we take data from multiple sources, including software decoders that I've written, APRS, and via APRS, we get data from these Pico balloons via the Whisper network. And they're all displayed on sond hub amateur. So you can go there and you can see the most recent position of a plethora of balloons all around the world. And there's probably about, you know, 10 or 15 of them in the air at any one time. Sond hub, we generally see across the two sites, maybe 400 users concurrently. And then, of course, a few days ago, this hit the mainstream media and we saw that shoot up, you know, double, triple. And then for a brief period, we had apparently 6,000 users at once, which is a little bit surprising. We're getting a lot of interest now because it is one of the prime ways to track amateur high altitude balloons. It is the only dedicated high altitude balloon tracking site out there. Our site allows for also for forward prediction, so predicting where the balloons are going to travel, which is really useful for people that have launched them. They want to click a button and work out where their balloon's going to be in the next few days, and we can provide that.
For those that are interested actually in this and the science behind it and experimenting, I'll put some links in the description below how you can learn more about the amateur radio balloon launches and how you can track them, including the link to the Sondhub website. If you found this video valuable, then please subscribe to my YouTube channel right here. If you want to learn more about amateur radio and the experiments that we do, then there is also a video above which may interest you.